Hello friends, Nishan here, welcoming you to the 6th episode of Healthwise with Manipal Hospitals. So today we'll be discussing about a very serious medical condition. Around estimated number of people dying because of this disease is around 2.5 million every year. Every minute you can see one person dying because of this disease. So this disease is none other than cancer. So what is blood cancer? How does it happen? Whom does it affect? Is there any cure for this blood cancer? So to answer to all these questions of yours, we have with us a very well-known hemato-oncologist from Manipal Hospital, Dr. Mallikarjun Kalashetty. So I'd like to welcome Dr. Mallikarjun Kalashetty to the show.
Hello.
Hello, sir. How are you, sir?
I'm fine, thank you. How are you?
Yeah, I'm doing great, sir.
Right.
So without wasting any more time, I'll just go to all the questions which we have got from the viewers.
Right.
So what is BMD? This is the first question. And I'm sure like many of us may not be knowing what is BMD.
Right.
Yeah. So doctor, what is BMT?
Yes. So bone marrow transplantation is one of the complex medical procedures that we use to treat various both benign and malignant disorders of the blood. So just now I overheard you talking about the cancers, right? So cancers are broadly divided into liquid cancers, which affect the blood, and solid tumors, which are basically solid organ cancers. So I, being a hemato-oncologist, will deliberate more on the liquid tumors, right? So the liquid cancers are divided again into leukemias, lymphomas, and leukemias are acute and chronic leukemias. And bone marrow transplantation is used in treating some of these. So majority of them can be treated with only chemotherapy. So the acute myeloid leukemia, which is intermediate to high risk, lymphomas which have relapsed, or multiple myeloma where we use autologous stem cell transplantation, are some of the common blood cancers wherein we use bone marrow transplantation. Now the bone marrow transplantation word itself is a historic term. Now we are moving away from it, and we more aptly call it as hematopoietic stem cell transplantation, because what we use are the stem cells, and it is not necessary that we have to collect them from the bone marrow. So initially people were collecting all the stem cells from the bone marrow, wherein the patient would be taken to an operation theater, would be given a general anesthesia, and then we would aspirate lots of the bone marrow stem cells and then use them as the cells for treating the recipient or a patient. Now it is, in majority of the hematological malignancies, the stem cells are collected from the peripheral blood. So we give them a medicine to mobilize the stem cells, and then we collect them like collecting platelets, for example. And those are called as peripherally mobilized stem cells, which is done through apheresis. And so now we more aptly call it as hematopoietic stem cell transplantation and not as bone marrow transplantation, because you can essentially collect the stem cells from the peripheral blood too. Yeah.
Okay. Doctor, I had a question.
Yeah.
What exactly is a stem cell?
Right. So stem cell is kind of a mother cell, which is different from more differentiated cells. Now, in fact, as you know, the stem cells can give way to many organ systems and many cells. So when we talk about stem cell in hematology, we're talking about hematopoietic stem cell, which kind of give rise to white blood cells, give rise to red blood cells, give rise to platelets, right? So stem cells not only can differentiate into more specialized cells and organs, but they can also divide and what is called a self-renewal. They can also divide into more stem cells. So that makes them different from other cells. So if it is a differentiated cell, for example, a neutrophil or a red cell or a platelet, they can't go back and make other cells. Whereas a stem cell can differentiate into other cells and also divide into more stem cells. So they have both self-renewal and differentiating capacity.
Okay. So moving towards the next question, like what are the other words which describe what BMD?
Right. So historically, we all used to call that as bone marrow transplantation. So now we also call it as peripheral blood transplantation. Some people say blood and marrow transplantation. But I think the term which is more apt is called as hematopoietic stem cell transplantation, wherein we basically are using hematopoietic stem cells and helping regeneration of a diseased marrow with a healthy stem cells. So I think we should just call it as hematopoietic stem cell transplantation.
Okay. And one more question, doctor. I'm sure the many are confused. Is BMD a disease? Is it a surgery?
Right.
Is it a procedure?
Right.
What exactly is
right.
BMD?
So bone marrow transplantation is in fact a treatment for many diseases. So it could be some of the common diseases that we use, which are treated by the bone marrow transplantation, are acute myeloid leukemia, multiple myeloma, lymphomas which are relapsed, thalassemia, some rare primary immunodeficiency disorders. So bone marrow transplantation is a procedure, it is not a disease, and it is done to treat many disorders. Now, it is also called as hematopoietic stem cell transplantation, as I've told you, and there is no surgery involved. So many people have this misconception that this is a very painful thing, that we are going to break the bones of a donor and then, you know, fix something into the recipient. No, none of that happens. So basically we collect the stem cell, which in majority of the cases is like collecting platelets on an apheresis machine, wherein you don't even have to go to operation theater, right? And those collected stem cells are transfused back into the recipient after what is called as a conditioning chemotherapy, which is essentially destroying the diseased bone marrow and then giving them the stem cell. And the process of giving the stem cell is also like just a blood transfusion. So there is no surgery involved, and it is not painful procedure at all. It is just a misconception.
So when you extract the bone marrow, like, there is no kind of pain or something?
No, so as I said, the stem cells can be collected so by two ways. One is peripherally mobilized stem cells, wherein we give them a growth factor to mobilize these stem cells which are essentially in the bone marrow to the peripheral blood. And then we put them on the apheresis machine and collect them. So there is no pain, there is no general anesthesia needed.
Any side effects of that?
So people may develop some pain, some dyscalculia when we give them the growth factor, but largely it is a safe procedure. So remember, whenever we take stem cells from a donor who is essentially healthy, we give a lot of importance to the safety of the donor. So largely, donors are absolutely safe, and there is no short-term or long-term toxicity or side effect because of the procedure to the donor. Now, in some disorders like bone marrow failures, like primary immunodeficiency disorders and aplastic anemia, it is preferable to collect the stem cells from the bone marrow. So in such a case, we take the donor, who is a normal person, after due diligence and after some pre-transplant workup, if they are found healthy, we give them general anesthesia, take them to the operation theater. There we collect stem cells from the bone marrow. So if we need to collect the stem cells from the bone marrow, only then, which is largely in marrow failures and aplastic anemias and primary immunodeficiency disorders. But for most of the malignant disorders, even that is not needed.
Okay. Yeah.
So based on the source of collection, it is peripherally collected stem cell or collected from the bone marrow.
Yes. So moving to the next question, that is, what are the different types of VMD?
Right. So that is a very important question. Again, many people have this confusion. So we largely divide the transplantation, bone marrow transplantation, into an autologous transplantation, wherein the source of stem cell is the patient himself. So this is then commonly done in disorders, say like multiple myeloma, like relapsed leukemia, relapsed lymphoma, wherein we give them chemotherapy to minimize the disease that they have and collect stem cells from the patient himself. So essentially, those stem cells are of the patient only. And then the patient is given a lot of high-dose chemotherapy, which would essentially destroy all of the bone marrow and then reinfuse the stem cells which are collected from the patient himself. So here, there is no immune adverse event, there is no graft-versus-host disease, and this is largely a safe transplantation. So this is called as autologous stem cell transplantation. Now, the second type is called as allogenic bone marrow transplantation, wherein the donor is somebody else. So this allogenic stem cell transplantation is divided again into matched sibling donor stem cell transplantation, wherein the patient's own brother or sister will give the stem cells. So that is one of the safer.
What
safer
is this called, doctor?
It is called as matched sibling. So matched sibling is a brother or sister. So they have, if they are actually identical, we take the stem cells from them, and they are the best donors if we have them. But what is happening, unfortunately, is with the families becoming smaller and smaller, with lesser and lesser siblings, the probability of finding a matched sibling is less. So then we do what is called as unrelated donor transplant. So there are donor registries across the globe. There is a European donor registry, there is an American donor registry, and there is a German donor registry. So we do the HLA typing of the patient and then submit that information to these donor registries. So if there is a good match, basically 10 by 10 match, then that voluntary donor can give the cell. So that is unrelated donor allogenic stem cell transplantation. Okay. Now, for a country like ours, which is 1.25 billion people, we don't have robust donor registries. We're working towards that. So sometimes, because in American or German or European, we don't have our own adequate representation and changing ethnicity, we may not get a full match donor. So then we have what are called as family half match transplant or haplotransplant, wherein the HLA is not identical but half match. So in some diseases, we have started doing what is called as haplotransplant also. So essentially, it is autologous transplantation, where stem cells are from the donor, matched sibling donor transplantation, which is a type of allogenic transplantation, the stem cells are from a fully HLA identical brother or sister, matched unrelated donor transplant, wherein it is not a family member, it is not a brother or sister, but somebody else whose HLA is identical to you, and they give the stem cell. And the third one is partially matched donor stem cell transplantation. It could be half matched from the family donor. Yeah.
Okay. So, viewers, there are three types of VMD, as doctor said. So moving towards the first question, that is from Deepak Kumar. What happens after the bone marrow or stem cells have been transplanted to the patient?
Right. So this, as I said, this is one of the most complicated and quite intense treatment. So it is important as physicians we give full information to the patient and to the caregivers, because this is not something which is going to get over in a day. You know, oftentimes we call this as a marathon of treatment, right? So basically what we do is there is a disease which is basically refractory or has come back or relapsed. So basically we have to give you intense treatment to control the disease as much as possible. So that is called a salvage therapy in lymphomas. So once we do that, once the disease is under maximal remission, they will be taken to this highly sterile ward called as bone marrow transplantation ward. They will be given conditioning chemotherapy to destroy remaining abnormal or disordered bone marrow. And then we collect the stem cells either from a healthy related donor or unrelated donor, and those cells are infused back to the patient. Now it may take about 3 to 4 weeks for those cells to home into the bone marrow, and then what we call as engraftment, meaning those healthy stem cells making the blood cells again. Now in this interim of stem cell infusion to engraftment, the patient will be under strict surveillance. He may have infections, he may need prostate antimicrobial agents, so he may have mucositis, needing, you know, parenteral nutrition, and oftentimes the blood product support. You know, if the platelet counts drop a lot, he will be given platelet transfusion. If the hemoglobin drops, he will be given the red cell transfusion. So we need to do a good supportive care. We need to be careful about the infections. We have to support them if they have mucositis and severe pain till the engraftment. Once the engraftment occurs and once the patient is stable, taking orally, moving around in the ward, then we discharge them from the bone marrow transplant room. They will also be on multiple medications, some of them to prevent what is called as a graft versus host disease, some of them to prevent infections in them. So we need to monitor them closely post-transplant. So after about 4 to 6 weeks of transplantation and they engraft, they go back, and then we kind of keep them under close surveillance for another 60 to 90 days. So first day 100s are critical, so we call it as first 100 days of transplantation. Mm-hmm. And if people are well, from there on, there will be some potential toxicity, but it will be much less. Yeah.
Okay.
So the first 100 days are very critical.
Very critical.
Yeah.
Okay. So there's the next question from Deepak Kumar. What are the possible side effects of BMT and PBSCD?
Right. So bone marrow transplantation toxicities can be largely divided into the early or short term and the long term toxicities. The short-term toxicities could be because of the conditioning chemotherapy. Many of them will have nausea, will have vomiting, will have ulcers in the mouth, will have severe pain. Some of them will lose the taste of the food. They will not eat well. They will lose some weight. And some people may develop infections during what is called as neutropenia period, which is called as neutropenic infections. And some people will also have diarrheas. So bad fungal and viral infections too. And sometimes the engraftment may be late in some people, and then those issues can be more. But then there are enough medications to take patients through this critical period, and also to make sure that we give them good supportive care. And in the long term, they may have what is called as in allogeneic stem cell transplantation, the stem cells which are given to the recipient may mount an immune attack called as graft versus host disease, which can be crippling in about 10%, but then it can be seen in about 20 to 30% of these transplants. And there can be organ toxicities because of the conditioning that we've given. So rarely it may affect their lungs, their heart, the GI system. But then with each passing year, the transplantation is becoming better because we have better drugs, better supportive medication, better antimicrobial agent. So the TRM, or what is called as transplant-related mortality, which used to be 30 to 40% historically, has come down to about 10 to 20% in the rest of the centers. So I think we are getting better at it, but there is still some potential for various complications, both short-term and long-term.
Okay. So this is one general question, actually. I'm sure all the viewers out there will be having this question in mind.
Right.
What is leukemia and what is thalassemia? How different it is?
No, those are actually, there is nothing similar between those. Yeah. So leukemia is a blood cancer. So leukemia can be acute or chronic. So the acute leukemias are acute lymphoblastic leukemia, acute myeloblastic leukemia. Whereas the chronic leukemias are again chronic myeloid leukemia and chronic lymphocytic leukemia. So these are blood cancers. Thalassemia is not a blood cancer. Thalassemia
so it's
is
different types of blood cancers.
Leukemia, No. Thalassemia is not a cancer at all. So leukemia is cancer. Thalassemia is a disorder of hemoglobin called as hemoglobinopathy, wherein the child cannot make good red cells. So that's why they will need red cell transfusions. So thalassemia again clinically is divided into thalassemia major, thalassemia intermediate, and thalassemia minor. Thalassemia major is a dreadful condition wherein a child will have both thalassemia mutations inherited from father and mother. So that will be a homozygous state for the child. So he will need red cell transfusion soon after birth, say perhaps from 6 months to 2 years, for the rest of the child's life. So that is a humongous thing for parents, for the child. So multiple transfusions have many complications, and there are no medicines at this point in time which can cure child and make child transfusion independent. And the only way to treat thalassemia is by doing what is called as bone marrow transplantation. And lucky if the child has a mass sibling donor, in which case the results are very good and the complications are much less. So again, if there is a child with thalassemia major and if they have sibling, we say as soon as possible we must do a HLA typing of the child and the siblings. And if there is a sibling who is a full match, then we must proceed to transplantation as soon as we can so that the transplant outcomes are much superior. So again, leukemia is a cancer, thalassemia is not a cancer. Thalassemia is a condition where child will require chronic blood transfusion.
Okay. So, and the next question is from Raj. How are BMT and PBSCT used in cancer treatment?
Right. So I think.
And he has one more question from Raj himself. How is bone marrow donation different from blood donation?
Right. So I think we kind of touched on these topics already.
Is it something like O positive, B positive?
No, already. So okay. The PBSCT is peripheral blood stem cell transplantation. So wherein we have told you the stem cells are essentially collected from after mobilization of the stem cells. Patients are put on a machine called as apheresis machine, which removes the stem cell and gives the rest of the blood back to the donor. So this is just a day care procedure. And there is no invasiveness at all. The donor does not even need anesthesia, right? So that is peripherally collected stem cells, peripheral blood stem cell collection. Okay. His other question was, what is bone marrow collection, right? So if you give the donor the anesthesia, take him to the operation theater, and then they collect the same stem cells from a posterior superiliac spine, that is a hip bone. So from the posterior part of the hip bone, if you collect the stem cells, so that is called as a bone marrow donation of the stem cell. So that is done in few disorders, but majority of the patients we do a peripheral blood stem cell collection only. What was the other part of the question that he had?
He had one more question. How is the donor's marrow matched to the patient's marrow?
Yes. So no. So the blood grouping is what is commonly used, right? So ABO grouping and RH typing for the blood transfusion. But we use what is called as a tissue typing or a HLA typing. So for the bone marrow transplantation. So we basically have a HLA system which has HLA, B, DR, DQ, and DQB1. So those are the various HLA antigens. So we typically match at least 6 to 10 antigens from the recipient and the donor. And if it's a familial donor, that is if it's a sibling, then even if he's a 6x6 match, that is good enough present day. And if it's an unrelated donor, would like to have at least 10 antigen match, you know, 10x10 or even 9x10 is okay in some of the disorders. So that is also, so the matching is called as HLA matching, not the blood group matching. In fact, we can do the blood or bone marrow transplantation even if there is a blood group mismatch between the donor and recipient. So many people think, doctor, the blood group is not same, can I be a donor? Absolutely. So we could do a bone marrow transplantation or a peripheral blood bone marrow transplantation even if the blood group is not matching. So blood group matching is not necessary for the transplantation.
Is there any benefits of donating a bone marrow?
Well,
like they say, every 6 months if you donate blood, there are lots of benefits of that.
Yes. Yeah. No. So it is a great thing itself. You are saving somebody's life. I'm sure that itself is of paramount importance. Apart from that, if you're asking, is there any health-wise? No, I wouldn't say that. So blood donation, perhaps many people do it once in 6 months, which is great again. So I wouldn't do a bone marrow donation just for, being healthy. But then there is no long-term adverse event. And you are actually giving a life to somebody. That itself is a fantastic thing to do.
Okay.
Yeah.
So the next question is from Devamalya. She has three questions. First one is, why does a patient need a bone marrow transplant? How long does it take to recover from a bone marrow transplant? Can you donate bone marrow if you have a sickle cell trait?
Right. Yes. So very apt questions, actually. So bone marrow transplantation, how long it takes for them to recover is the first question. So as I said, the first part of the challenge is to get adequate HLA matching. So once if that is done, once we infuse, we call that as a day zero or a stem cell infusion day, which is typically done after conditioning. So conditioning would take about 7 days. And then we give the stem cells, which is stem cell infusion day. So post stem cell infusion typically takes about 3 to 4 or in fact 3 to 5 weeks for those cells to engraft. Engraft is they going to the bone marrow, homing there, and then making the normal cells. So it may take about 20 to 30 days in majority of the cases. So that is the first part, which is called as engraftment. Now once that happens, they will be discharged from the bone marrow unit, but then they'll be closely followed up for the next couple of months to see the drug level, to look for any infection, to look for any adverse events of the medicine. So in about 70 to 100 days, so most of the acute issues are resolved. But once the bone marrow transplantation is done, we would want to keep them under close follow-up for several months, you know. So if your question is, doctor, would they be 100% normal at the end of 100 days and can they do everything? So we still think the immune reconstitution, so immune system is the system of the body which helps us fight infections. So it may take several months post 100 days too for it to become normal. So during that point in time, we still continue them on some prophylactic antimicrobials. So for them to attain some kind of stability, I would say it takes about 60 to 100 days. But the engraftment itself, you know, discharge from the hospital itself will occur much sooner than that, in about 3 to 4 weeks.
Okay. The next question is from Faisal. What are the risks associated with bone marrow transplant?
I think we have discussed that, right? Both short-term and long-term toxicity.
So, Faisal, the doctor has already answered this question. So, moving towards the next question, that is from Krishnan.
Right.
What diseases are treated most often with bone marrow transplant?
Yes. So, across the globe, the common disorders which are treated with bone marrow transplantation are multiple myeloma, which is one of the common indications for autologous stem cell transplantation. Acute myeloid leukemia, which is a common indication for allogenic bone marrow transplantation. Relapsed and refractory lymphomas are commonly treated with transplantation. But in Asian and other parts of the globe, where thalassemia is a very, very common condition, so they account for a sizable number of transplants. So there are lots of thalassemia major children in India and in Asia-Pacific region who need allogenic stem cell transplantation. And unfortunately, because of financial constraints, because of non-availability of the donor, because of lack of expertise, many of these children continue to suffer all their lives. So thalassemia is an important indication for transplantation. There are certain rare immune disorders called as primary immunodeficiency disorders, which can be cured with bone marrow transplantation. So these are some of the common diseases that we treat with bone marrow transplantation.
So the next question is from Anmol. How does survival of patients receiving a transplant from an unrelated donor compare to those from a related donor?
Oh, very, very, very nice question. So I forgot to mention aplastic anemia in the last segment. So aplastic anemia is another dreadful condition wherein the bone marrow, which is basically a factory which makes these cells, kind of fails. So aplastic anemia is one of the disorders which can be very effectively treated with bone marrow transplantation if they have a good donor, right? So his question was, I'm sorry, what was that?
It is a big question, sir. Yes. How does survival of patients receiving a transplant from an unrelated donor
differ from a matched? Yes. So when we started transplantation, right, so we would always say it is preferred to have a full matched HLA identical sibling donor. But as you know, the probability that a sibling is a full match to a recipient is 1 in 4, that is 25%, and that is because we inherit one HLA haplotype from mother and one HLA haplotype from the father. So with the shrinking family size, it is becoming lesser and lesser to find a fully matched HLA sibling donor. So when the transplants were started historically, the sibling donor full matched transplants were always better than the unrelated donor transplant. Now we are getting to a stage where a 10 by 10 matched unrelated donor transplant is almost as good as HLA identical sibling donor. And that is because we are getting better at transplants. So to answer his question in short, to answer this question in short, now there is not much difference between a 10 by 10 match unrelated donor to a fully matched sibling donor. They both fare very well.
Okay. So the next question is from Kritika. What is the treatment for bone marrow edema? She has three more questions. Can smokers donate bone marrow? Why can't we use a bone marrow treatment for the pancreas in case of type 2 diabetes?
Right. So I think she's going out of my area of expertise. So one, as a physician, I should never say it is okay to smoke, right? No, please don't smoke. Second, so smoking is not a contraindication for bone marrow donation or stem cell donation. So we can, if the patient is healthy, has no other comorbid illnesses, we can surely collect stem cells from the smoker too. And the other question that she had.
What is the treatment for bone marrow edema?
No, we don't. The bone marrow edema is not a condition. There are 10 clinical conditions, or in fact more than that, which can cause bone marrow edema. So that does not need a specific treatment. We have to treat the underlying cause. Her other question is, can we use a bone marrow transplant for the pancreas?
In case of type 2 diabetes.
No, no. So we'll have to do islet cell transplantation, which we don't do, and bone marrow transplantation has got nothing to do with pancreatic disorders.
Okay.
Yeah.
So next question is from Alfia. Does the bone marrow of all bones produce immune cells?
Right. So that is another conception, you know, the misconception, shall I say, is that where do you take the bone marrow from, and is it qualitatively same as everywhere else? Is it not? Yes. So we don't have to do 10 pricks in 10 bones to collect stem cells. We basically do it from the hip bone called as posterior superior iliac spine. In fact, as I said, in vast majority, we don't even do that. We do the peripheral blood stem cells now, right? So even the bone marrow collected from a hip bone is good enough. So any stem cell collected from there, we don't have to, you know, pick and poke into multiple bones. That is not needed. So, and essentially, they are the same stem cells which will give rise to a robust new hematopoietic system in the recipient. Yeah.
The next question is from Prachi. Are there any adverse effects of removing bone marrow for stem cell treatment?
To the donor, is it not? So that is one of the questions that we get repeatedly asked. Is there a short-term complication to the donor? Is there a long-term complication to the donor? Will the donor's bone marrow fail? No, none of that happens actually. So when we take the stem cells from the donor, there is no long-term adverse event to him. In the short term, some of them may have local pain. Some of them have dropping hemoglobin because we collect significant amount of the blood and the stem cells in it. So, and we give them some medicines for the pain in the short term, and also perhaps give them some hematinics to improve, recover their hemoglobin. So, apart from that, there are no other short or long term toxicity to the donor. As I said, as physicians, we always try to make sure that the donor safety is of paramount importance. Yes. And unlike many organ transplants wherein, you know, there is some potential risk for the recipient because they undergo surgery, the organ needs to be harvested, not here. So here it is like giving a blood, you know, in majority of the cases where I'm sure all of them know how to donate us in a platelet. So the same machine which is used for apheresis of the platelets is used for stem cell collection. So okay. There is no difference at all.
The next question is from Ayush. What is the difference between a stem cell transplant and a bone marrow transplant? He has one more question.
Right.
Other than
so I think we'll answer that.
I guess you answer that question.
Yeah. So if you collect the stem cells from the bone marrow, which is done in some bone marrow failure conditions like aplastic anemia and primary immunodeficiency disorder, it is called as bone marrow collected stem cells or bone marrow transplantation, which is what everybody knows about. But now we can collect the stem cells from the peripheral blood mobilized stem cells through the apheresis machine. So in which case it is called as peripheral blood stem cell transplantation. So it depends on where we collect the stem cells from.
Okay. And one more question from him was, can we use this bone marrow transplant to treat any other diseases other than cancer?
So yes. So for example, thalassemia. For example, primary immunodeficiency disorder. For example, sickle cell anemia, which are not cancers. What we can use. And there are certain rare metabolic disorders where we can use it. So surely we can use it. But many people will ask, there is something called as stem cell therapy for degenerative disorder, which is a different field altogether and which is still in nascent stage where people are doing clinical trials. But we are not talking about that. Yeah. So we are talking about basically hematological conditions which could be benign, meaning non-cancerous like thalassemia, sickle cell disease, primary immunodeficiency disorders, or cancerous conditions like acute leukemia, myeloma, lymphoma, where you can use bone marrow transplantation.
Okay. So next question is from Priyanka. Why do we need a donor for the bone marrow when we can harvest from our own body?
Right, so we have talked about that, right? So in some disorders, we actually collect from the same patient, which are called as autologous stem cell transplantation. So in which case, we don't need a donor. But there are some disorders where autologous bone marrow transplantation does not work. You know, it doesn't cure. That is when we need stem cells from the other donor.
Now, and how do we understand
which are the diseases which are
right?
Yes. So that is based on the large number of clinical trials. You know, so we know now that multiple myeloma, for example, we commonly do an autologous transplantation because this disease affects the elderly people. They're quite fragile and frail. And if you were to do a allogeneic stem cell transplantation, there is a very high risk of transplant-related mortality and morbidity. On the contrary, a young fellow with aplastic anemia who has no stem cells. So you can't collect stem cells from him because he doesn't have any. So there we have to collect stem cells from the other donor. So there you can't do an autologous transplantation. You have to go for allogeneic transplantations. So it depends on the disease. It depends on the stage. And it largely depends on the circumstances. Yes.
Okay. So we have two questions from Pallavi. What is the difference between a general stem cell transplant and a bone marrow transplant? I guess you answered this already.
Yes.
Are there any permanent risks to the immune system after the procedure?
Right. So I think a couple of things. Again, to the recipient, yes. So the immune reconstitution is what we call. So the immune system becoming normal after an allogeneic transplantation may take several months, say 12 to 24 months, and after that it would be as good as normal. But in the interim, they will have some immune compromise. So that's the reason why. So we have to be very careful. They need to be under surveillance. They will have to take certain antimicrobial prophylaxis for a certain length of time post-transplant. Whereas the donor himself, no, there are no issues for the donor who gives the stem cells.
Okay. So three more questions from Rohit. What is stem cell mobilization?
Right.
What are the health complications for the donor? This you
right.
answered already.
Yes. Yes. Are so there, I think I can just briefly touch yeah. upon stem cell mobilization. So we have certain growth factors now. Basically what they do is they help in detachment of the stem cells from the bone marrow network and then help them mobilizing them into the peripheral blood, wherein they can be easily collected on an apheresis machine. So this largely helps us in avoiding a procedure of taking the donor to operation theater, doing those multiple iliac bone punctures. So this has made things very easy, and the product that we get after peripheral blood stem cell mobilization is also helps us in early engraftment. So if you were to collect the stem cells from the bone marrow and compare that with the peripherally collected stem cells, the engraftment is much earlier in the peripherally collected stem cell, which is fantastic.
Okay. Yeah. And the last question from Rohit is, are there any long-lasting results of a bone marrow transplant?
Oh, absolutely. So all this effort is of little worth if there are no long-lasting, right? So depending on the disease, depending on the condition of the patient, some of these people, to the tune of 60 to 70% can have a long-term disease-free survival. So depending on what kind of disease we treat. So there is definitely a long-term survival. There is definitely a cure in sizable number of patients. But then we can't generalize that. We'll have to talk to each patient based on their particular disease, their stage, and what kind of their fitness level is, So it's multiple factors. So I don't think it makes sense for me to say all of them will do well. So similarly, we can't say that, nobody will do well. So majority of them will do well, but then it depends on an individual to individual case and their fitness and what kind of conditioning we can use and what is their disease status.
Okay. So we have come towards the end of the questions from the viewers. So moving towards the next segment of the show, that is Mythbuster, we have three myths. First one is the success rate is more only when you collect the bone marrow from a family member. Is it true or false?
Well, so it is not false totally, in the sense the results are best if we have a HLA identical brother or sister, that is sibling donor. There is no doubt. So the outcome is always superior if there is a fully matched HLA identical donor. But now we are moving to an era where if there is a HLA 10 by 10 matched unrelated donor, the results are as good. So that way it is a little myth, right? So kind of it is both yes and no.
Okay.
Yeah.
So it's a myth.
Right.
Okay. So the next myth number two is bone marrow is taken from the spine, or they have been taken out from the chunk of a bone?
No, so we don't move close to the spine at all. We don't want to injure the spine. We actually take it from a hip bone called as iliac bone. Posterior superior iliac spine is where we actually insert. So the spine is left untouched. So there is no damage to the spine of the donor. No, we take it from the iliac bone commonly.
Okay. The next myth number three is, can I donate marrow because I am not, can I donate a marrow because I am an alcoholic, I smoke, is it okay if I donate?
Well, it is not okay to smoke and drink, but yes, if you are healthy, then surely you can donate,
And this is myth number four, the final one, doctors carve out donor to get the bone marrow, and it's the bones are left with the cracks.
No,
is it true?
No, we don't break bones. We use small needle to make small puncture holes and
in
then
the bone
aspirate. Itself. Yes. Okay. No, so no, we have never had a broken bone. Nobody ever, I think. It's just a small needle used to make small hole and then collect. It is not a surgery even.
Okay. So we have come to the end of the show, and I'm sure Dr. Mallikarjun has answered all your questions related to BMT, blood cancer, and now you're sure that there is a cure, and the cure what is being done is really effective, and yeah, probability of success rate is really more.
Yes. So just to emphasize, When in doubt, seek the help from an expert. Early diagnosis is of paramount importance, and going to the right place at the right time might save many lives. And have no misconceptions about the bone marrow transplantation. It is not surgery, it is not a painful procedure, and even if there is a blood group mismatch, we could still go ahead and do the bone marrow transplantation. So remember that.
Yeah. Don't go to a Google doctor, go to a specialized consultant.
Right.
Yeah.
Right.
So
yes.
Thank you all. We'll be coming
thank
up.
You.
Yeah,
thank
we'll
you
be coming up with the other episodes of Health Vibes. Thank you, see you, stay fit, stay healthy, stay happy. Thank
Bye
you.
Bye.